I think we've been fortunate to make some important discoveries, but obviously you don't do that in a vacuum. You do that because there are great people giving you the resources you need to do exciting things. And equally, I've been, really blessed by having really terrific people in the lab over the year. And the NIH is an amazing place where people really do come from around the world, and then they give their heart and soul to tough problems. And the other thing that I'd say is that as much as this we're celebrating NIAM's birthday, the NIH in general is just a really amazing place to work. It's highly collaborative. So I've been really very fortunate over the years to work with people like Warren Leonard and Bill Paul, and more recently with people like Yasmin Belkade and NIAID. Just because they're in NIAID doesn't mean we can't talk to them. So it's really been an amazing opportunity. And I've used up almost my first 30 seconds here, so I'll move on quickly. So I'm going to talk a bit about the discovery of a patient, Fabio Condotti, who's now in the Genome Institute, and how that led us to go back to the lab to understand this gene and then go back to the bedside again. So it's a bedside to bench to bedside story. And again, in the way of disclosure from the beginning, this work has been also supported in part through a longstanding collaboration with Pfizer. And we here at the NIH have a patent related to this, and so I need to disclose this. And I can tell you that I've literally made hundreds of dollars over this patent over years. So you can worry about my ability to be objective. Okay, so this was actually the cell phone that Steve used to call me with when NIAMS first started 25 years ago. But the point is that it looks a lot like my cell phone at that time, the communication is obviously critical for all aspects of life. But in the immune system, communication really is absolutely vital, and that's what this talk will be about. So you have all these specialized cells in the immune system that are critical for host defense. But it's really critical that they talk to each other and tell each other what to do and really tailor the responses in with different types of infections, different types of microorganisms. But there's a downside. And the way cells communicate is through these things called cytokines shown here. So that's what the arrows represent. Cytokines produce these proteins that then bind to receptors that I'll tell you more about and then tell the cells what to do. But there's a downside to this, and that is that cytokines are also critical drivers of autoimmune diseases, the focus of much of NIAM's research. Now, we know a lot about cytokines and their role in autoimmune disease based on animal models or measurements in patients, but also now the advances in genomics, where we know that these really are risk alleles for these diseases. But equally, we know from experiments where we've generated novel drugs targeting cytokines that they're very effective treatments for a number of autoimmune diseases. So these are all the different types of cytokine receptors that you have, and you can see drugs that have already FDA approved. Dan mentioned anakinra, but you know about TNF inhibitors, et cetera. The question that we were interested in addressing some time ago was, can you target intracellular signaling? So let me tell you how we got involved in that. So again, these are the major families of cytokine receptors. You have about 200 or so cytokines. But a large proportion of cytokines bind to this family of receptors here. These are the so-called type 1, type 2 cytokine receptors. Not such a great name, but it is what it is. But about 60 of our cytokines use this class of receptors. So everyone knew these receptors were important. But what was not known was how this class of receptors basically told cells what to do. What was the intracellular signaling pathway that led from signals outside the cell to telling the nucleus to change the behavior of the cell? So that led us onto the quest to begin to find these molecules. We found one molecule called JAK3, shown here. But JAK3 is in a family of small family of kinases, JAK1, JAK2, JAK3, and just to make it impossible for non-immunologists to remember this, TYK2. Again, it's historical. That's how these things get named. But again, time is short, and I want to stay on time. But in thinking about Francis's comments and Dan's comments, back when we were doing this, it was actually really hard to clone a gene. I mean, it just seems ludicrous now. Now you just, sit at home drinking a cup of coffee, and you go on the internet, and you could find out all this stuff. But It took us months and months and months, and the way you would do sequencing at the time, they had these big sequencing gels, and I literally read every base pair of JAK3, A, G, base pair by base pair, and then you'd look and you'd say, well, Dan, you probably did some of this as well. You'd say, is that 1C or 2Cs? And it was really, you'd be lucky to get 200 base pairs at a time, and then we were really fortunate being at the NIH. We had a supercomputer, and the supercomputer could give you the blast search, again, which you could do sitting at home, in a few seconds. That would take us, astonishingly, it would take us 24 hours, And so, as you were saying in the beginning, Steve, I mean, it's just amazing what you can do now with the human genome. But I go on and on, and I'm watching the time here. But the key question is, having discovered JAK3, and we thought it was important because we thought this class of receptors was important, the key answer really came from a patient shown here on the next slide. So this is a patient that Fabio Condotti, who was in my lab at the time, but had done a work with Gigi Notarangelo in Brescia, Italy. This child here, I won't go into the details of her clinical presentation, but she presented with pneumocystis pneumonia, and she had a primary immunodeficiency. And what Gigi and Fabio and we found out, and then later worked with Warren Leonard and Rebecca Buckley, found that these patients had JAK3 mutations. So they present with a disease that's very similar to what the bubble boy presented with. They have defects in T cells, B cells, and NK cells, but she's obviously a little girl. Warren Leonard had discovered that the bubble boy syndrome is due to mutations of the common gamma chain. And with Warren Leonard, we had shown that that's the way that JAK3 works. Going back in this previous slide, that JAK3 associates with the common gamma chain. So that led us to sequence this gene in these patients, and we found that, in fact, they had JAK3 mutations, patients like this. Now, we know that in these patients, you can cure these patients with stem cell transplants, and we really even knew this before we knew the basis of the disease. So that's the good news for these patients. But it also had an important scientific lesson, which had pointed to the fact that this gene was critical for the immune system, not critical for other systems, brain, liver, et cetera, et cetera. So that led us to argue that maybe making inhibitors of JAK3 would represent a new class of immunosuppressive drugs, and that's the NIH patent that I referred to. So again, this summarizes a little bit what I told you. So in these girls, we found mutations of JAK3. With Warren Leonard, we had shown that JAK3 associates with the common gamma chain, which he had found was associated with the bubble boy syndrome, X-SCID. So in principle, we thought that this was an ideal target for making an immunosuppressive drug because we knew from this little girl that you would, if you inhibited this molecule, you wouldn't have renal and metabolic problems, problems you have with other drugs that are used for immunosuppression. So I went to this meeting a long time ago, 1993, and I ran into a colleague who I'd actually, we were sort of friendly competitors, if you will, when we were working on another project. But Paul Chingalian, had moved to Pfizer, and I said, Paul, what are you doing here at this lymphocyte and antibody meeting? And he said, well, I'm working at Pfizer now. I'm looking for targets of kinases that we can start working on as new immunosuppressive drugs. And I said, oh, Paul, have I got the kinase for you? I've got this amazing kinase. It's terribly important for the reasons that I just told you. So Paul actually bought it, and now 18 years later, in fact, there's not just one JAK inhibitor that's out there, there's multiple, so I'll just review that for a second. So the Pfizer drug is called tofacitinib, it's also referred to as CP69550, and it's in the phase three studies were just reported in the EULAR meetings in London a couple of weeks ago or so. And what we know from this is that these drugs now have efficacy that really is comparable to the biologics. So the biologics, of course, were revolutionary in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis, but these drugs really have a comparable effectiveness. And more importantly, in many cases, these drugs are used in patients who failed biologics. Now, as I'll get to, the key question, the reason you do these big studies is safety, and I'll comment on that in a moment. But the drug is also being studied in psoriasis, phase three in psoriasis, phase two in inflammatory bowel disease, and I came back just yesterday from the transplant meetings, and this drug is being studied in transplantation as well. Now, There are a number of other JAK inhibitors that have been designed along the way. Ruxolitinib is a JAK1, JAK2 inhibitor. The idea of using this drug came from the finding that disease polycythemia vera is associated with gain-of-function JAK2 mutations. So that led to the idea of purposely targeting JAK1 and JAK2. But in fact, this drug has been used in rheumatoid arthritis as well, recalling that JAK3 and JAK1 both are important for signaling via this class of cytokines. So in one sense, a JAK1 inhibitor could have many of the same effects as a JAK3 inhibitor. And its effects in rheumatoid arthritis are similar to an extent to tofacitinib. Many other phase 1 and phase 2 trials on the way with JAK inhibitors, variety of diseases, not just in autoimmune diseases, but also in cancer, et cetera, et cetera. So there are probably more than 50 ongoing clinical trials with various JAK inhibitors, and the drugs do seem to be efficacious. That's very exciting. The key question is of course, going to be their safety. They appear to be reasonably so. You have increased incidence of infection in patients who get these drugs, but in a sense, that's not terribly surprising. With most of the drugs we use, you have some risk of infection, and that sort of seems to be the nature of what happens when you immunosuppress patients. But you don't have a large increase in opportunistic infections. That's a big one. There is an increased incidence of anemia. And what I didn't tell you is there are other cytokines like erythropoietin that are important for production of blood that use JAKs, and so that explains that, but the anemia is not dramatic. The other side effect that's been seen is increased lipids, and again, that was on one level a surprise, one level not a surprise. The drug tocilizumab, which blocks IL-6, also increases lipids, so the thought is that this is a reflection of the drug's ability to block IL-6, so in one sense, this is an oral tocilizumab, if you will, and that's at least part of the mechanism of this drug. But that's the question that we're working on hard, is trying to understand how these drugs are working. Are they predominantly affecting cytokines in the adaptive immune system? So again, what Dan pointed out was when we first started with this, we didn't even, the term innate immune system hadn't really been coined, but thanks to Dan's work and Charlie Janeway and others, we now know of the key role of the innate immune system. And so this is one of the things we're thinking about most recently. And then the big surprise with this, again, this is sort of more from one of the scientific talks where I talk a lot about what kinases are being targeted with these classes of drugs, but it really turns out that in the early days we thought that absolute specificity for kinases was going to be a key, and that really turns out not to be the case, so it has important implications for thinking about next generation JAK inhibitors and even next generation tyrosine kinase inhibitors in general. The big questions are here. Exactly how are we going to use these drugs? What are their efficacies relative to biologics? Are they equivalent? Will they supplant the use of some of the biologics in some circumstances? Will they supplant the use of steroids in some settings? Do they have some steroid sparing effect or other effects? So here's my dream. I don't know if this will actually turn out, and this is not real, just as a proviso. So my hope someday I'll go into, I'll have poison ivy, be walking and working in my backyard, get a little poison ivy, go to CVS, and be reaching for the steroid cream, but instead of the steroid cream, I'll be able to use the JAK inhibitor. Now, it's not totally fanciful. There are topical JAK inhibitors, ruxolitinib, that are being used in psoriasis. But obviously, these are the outstanding questions. But you can see where the insights from this one patient really gave us an idea of what targeting this pathway might be. So I'm going to stop right there, and thank you very much for your attention.